truck stop in White House, Tennessee, off I-65. It's probably 10, 15 miles north of Nashville. Got here at 8 o'clock this morning. Do our 10-hour reset. And 8 o'clock this morning, it was probably half full. There's quite a bit of space. And this is a big house. Looks like they got 10 fuel lanes. And I believe the Love's app said there's 150 spaces. And as you can see, there's two trucks parked over there illegally. And you got three trucks there. Trying to get their 30-minute break-in front of the fuel islands. There's trucks parked all the way around the perimeter. There's 150 spaces here, but there's probably 180 trucks. And this space beside me, here I want to window down. Big light pole back here, so I'm not supposed to park here. Had a couple people come over and look at it, and I just talked to a guy who was looking at it. I think he was thinking about parking there, but if they park here, I'm gonna have a hard time getting out, because there's trucks parked over here to my right, and there's no way to get out over there. I might have to turn left to get out of this spot, and if somebody parks there, their nose is going to be hanging out. I'm not going to be able to get out. So hopefully no one does. We've got about an hour and a half before we're going to leave to get back to Cincinnati, but this truck parking is total bullshit, and I don't know what these guys are thinking. I mean, you got to understand that we're all out here trying to do the same thing, and to park in ways that are limiting other people. So, for example, last night, I'm in southern Louisiana. I'm south of New Orleans. I'm right on the coast, picking up a load. I get loaded at 10:30 p.m. And I want to get the hell out of New Orleans because Hurricane Laura's coming, right? I want to get the hell out of Dodge. So I want to drive as far as I can to get away from that storm. And I got a load of steel. It was like 22 pallets. And they loaded them down the middle straight back. Now, most of the pallets weighed like 1,500 to 1,700 pounds, but there were two pallets that weighed 5,000 pounds. And so we were trying to figure out, okay, how do we want to put these pallets on the trailer to balance the load? So I had them put the two heavy pallets in the middle. I had my tandems set 10 feet from the rear of the trailer. Wasn't sure. I felt pretty confident based on the air pressure on my drive tire or my drive axle airbags that I was pretty close to weight, but I needed to scale. The place didn't have a scale. It's a real small place, tight getting in and out. You can see that on the video before. I need to go to a scale. And so we found a TA right before the Louisiana-Mississippi border at a gas can, and I needed fuel. I was down almost to 1/8 of a tank. So pulling this TA, and first off, I had trouble even pulling in because trucks are parked everywhere. They're parked on the off-ramp, they're parked on the on-ramps, they're parked in the entrance, they're parked all along the fence. Clearly marked no parking. as you get to a fuel island. Then fueled up, looked at the scales, and to get to the scales, you had to pull out of the fuel island and circle around parking spaces that were set up like an island of parking spaces that were back to back, and you had to circle around them and come back around to get to the scale. Well, there were drivers that were parked along that fence, no parking. And then there were drivers that parked on the side of that island of parking spaces and had completely blocked off anyone's ability to get back around to that back part of that lot. So the only way is if you went back there before you got fuel, which I had to get fuel, and so it was going to be impossible for me to get to the scale, and I desperately need to scale the truck, and luckily, because we were driving at night, that weigh station in Mississippi was closed. We got to another Love's in Mississippi and pulled in there. And most of the Love's, the TA, the scale wasn't by the fuel islands. I don't know why, but all the Love's I've been in, scales have been right beside the fuel lanes. And we were able to get the truck scaled, and we were overweight on the drives. And it was only 20 pounds overweight. And that was after I put in three-quarter tank of diesel. I never fill it up, because especially when I'm running close on weight, I don't want to fill it up full of fuel and add more weight to the drives. Yeah, we were over. So we had to slide the tandems forward a little bit. And then drove through from Mississippi through Alabama. Their weigh scale was closed, but hit Tennessee. It was almost 7 a.m. We hit Tennessee, and their scales were open. And I got pulled in, and got weighed, and my weight was good. Thank God we made that adjustment, because if we hadn't, I'd have been real close to being overweight on the drives. And again, I don't know what the fines are being overweight. I don't care if it's a dollar. I don't want to pay it. And I don't want that going on my safety record being overweight. But this parking is just, every rest area we went by was full. Trucks lined up and down the on and off ramps. Some of them half a mile past the on-ramp in the emergency lane, parked, which to me creates more, that's more of a safety hazard than being on duty too long. This hours of service has just got everything. Hours of service needs a hard look. But these drivers too, come on. It took me a week to figure out if I wanted to stop at a truck stop and get a shower, I was going to have to drive all night. And I was going to have to stop at like 8 a.m. in the morning. It's not rocket science. If you watch the truck stops, they start to fill up pretty quick around 5 p.m. And usually by 8 p.m. they're full. That's been my experience to this point. And then it's the opposite in the morning. At 5 a.m., guys start pulling out. And by 8 a.m., the place is half full. By 10 a.m., it's damn near empty. So why are all of us trying to drive at the same time? And that's kind of what that hours of service does. It puts everybody on the road at the same time, which is during the day, which is when everybody else is on the road. It just seems like more of a hazard to me. It doesn't make any sense. I'll drive at night. I mean, yeah, I get kind of tired. It takes me a day or two to kind of adjust to sleeping during the day and driving at night. We see a lot of deer. We saw hundreds of deer. We drove from Missouri to Louisiana, back up to Tennessee, and we've seen hundreds. Well over 100. I mean, I didn't count them. But when you're seeing, you know, 4 or 5 deer standing by the road every couple miles, it adds up. So, you know, that's a hazard. A hazard of driving at night. But the traffic's light. We drove through the south part of St. Louis at 3 in the morning, and there wasn't another car on the road or truck. Downtown St. Louis. So that's nice. Given that we drove through downtown New Orleans at 6 p.m. and it was holy crap. That was terrible. Cars everywhere. But yeah, this is pretty much gonna be SOP for us. We're gonna drive at night. Hit the truck stop in the morning. Yeah, we don't have to fight the crowds, plenty of parking, easy spaces to get in and out of, showers are all open, you don't have to wait. They're inside the truck stop, like, in the, I don't know what you want to call it, the lobby or whatever, you know, where they're selling everything, drinks and food. It's busy in there in the morning. We've been coming in, get parked, get our shower bags together, go take a shower, grab something to drink, and come back out, and if we're hungry, something to eat. We usually got something to eat in the truck. Come back out to the truck, chill for a little bit, lay down, go sleep, and wake up. 5-6 o'clock at night, pull out 7-8 o'clock, do it again. It's been working out well for us. I don't know, just a little bit about some of these drivers being a little more courteous, and maybe the government, you know, the Department of Transportation, if they want to limit your ability to drive, then they need to provide adequate parking along the interstates. I mean, you're making rules that's making it hard for these drivers to comply and park legally. Some of these guys got to be getting parking tickets out the ass the way they park. And I don't even know if. If it's legal to park on the on-ramp or off-ramp, I would think you could be ticketed for that if you weren't broke down, but I don't know. It ain't right. But there's things that I think the drivers can do, and there's things the government can do, and there's things that the private sector can do. I mean, build some more truck stops, shit. They're busy as hell. You're losing money. Every time I see a truck parked in the rest area or a truck parked on the off-ramp or the on-ramp, that's money the truck stop's losing. These guys could have been in here spending their money taking showers, buying your food, buying your drinks, playing in your little arcades. Heading for get a chance, I'll try a video when leaving this truck stop, because that might be an adventure. And then we'll try to get some videos of some of the off ramps and the rest areas. Y'all can see how full they are at night. Some of the ridiculousness. We had to pull over one rest area. It's been a couple nights ago. Truck parking, all the spaces were full, ramps were full, to the point where trucks had parked behind the trucks in the truck rest area, and I could barely fit through there. Just to pull up long enough to run and take a leak and come back. And only a few inches on each side of the truck. It was ridiculous. And then I wonder if you hit a truck that's parked illegally, who's at fault? That'd be a good question for an attorney. Or if any of y'all know, comment. But yeah, I'd like to think that if tail on my trailer caught the nose of a truck that was illegally parked, I'd like to believe he'd be at fault. Being illegally parked, but I don't know. I don't know what the law is. I should probably look it up. I'll find out, I'll let you know. Right now, we're getting ready to head out. Keep you posted.
Siemens in Cincinnati. I don't know which was worse, picking this load up or delivering it. Kind of in old downtown Cincinnati. The address they gave me was to the receiving portion of their building here. Wouldn't call it a warehouse because it's not really big enough to be called a warehouse, but it was on a different street than receiving. So shipping, and I don't know how well this GoPro is gonna pick this up. It's kind of dark. You can see that Jeep just went by. That is a boulevard. It's split in half by berm, curb berm, that's about 20 feet wide. Cars, you can see, parked all the way down it. It says no trucks. It's got a picture of a truck with a red circle and a line to it. That's the way the amazing Garmin diesel was bringing me. So we couldn't turn there. I couldn't even make that turn. Had to find a side road that ran straight into the entrance there, and I did that. I got into that lot, which was pretty small. There's a truck waiting there. It's tell them I'm there to pick up, and they say, oh, you got to go out of here and make a left. Well, the left they were telling me to make was that road. No, I can't make a left there. There's no way. You couldn't turn a pickup truck with a garden trailer and not hit the curb or the telephone pole on that. Because cars were parked right to the intersection. There was no way. So I had to find another road that ran that one right there. Make sure that guy's walking their stop sign. It's a little offset, but it kind of ran straight into this gate. Hitting trees with my tractor and my trailer because they're too low. Then pull up here. This is what I'm looking at as I come up to this gate. Right here's the gate. And I mean, they're nice. They open the gate and all. And I'm in the lane with the arrow. I'm in that left lane. So I gotta make this turn here. As you can see where my truck is, I gotta make this turn. Miss that mallard, that pallet they got sticking out there, and this retaining wall. I had to pull all the way up to that fence up there. And then I had to back it down into this hole. Now, mind you, it wasn't too bad at first, because I could pull way up. And I still couldn't pull up far enough to get the truck and trailer straight. So just a straight line back. But I got up there, a little bit of an angle. So I started angling back in. Got an angle back in, got it up close to the wall. I'm almost in the hole. I'm almost to the dock. And the shotgun's helping me. You know, it's just watching both sides. So I was having trouble seeing that mallard in that fence there. The guardrail. He says, hey, we got to open the doors. I'm like, oh, yeah. So I stopped for a minute. And you know, I wasn't thinking. That dooring all open. I can't even open my driver's door. And the first time I backed in the hole, I was closer than that. I was about 2 inches from that curb sticking out there. My mirror was almost touching this wall. So I had to pull all the way up. It's all sandy. Pull all the way up here. I give you guys a shot of this. Pulled all the way up. And I was just being mindful. I didn't want to cut it out too far. And there's not enough room up here. I pulled the nose all the way to the fence, and I was a foot away from the corner of this building from being able to open that door. So then I had to angle it back out across this yellow line, backing it up far enough away to get the door open. And I finally got the doors open. Pulled back up. I was at a much worse angle that time because I got the truck all out of position. But managed to get the back of the trailer, come back, kind of this way. Got it pretty close and then got back underneath. And got real close to the wall here. My mirrors and nose retracted. But I got it back down there in the first try. So. Stressful pickup and delivery. See, there is no room. And don't know how I'm gonna get out of here. I damn sure ain't going back out that gate. I'd have to back out of it. And then there's really no place to go. I can't back down that street to the stoplight. And I can make this turn up there to the left. I don't know if there's any way of getting out of there. It might open up enough that I can turn around. I still don't like the idea of going through that residential area that's been there probably since 1890. Where the streets are all about 10 foot wide. I don't like that. I don't know what. That looks like an old church there. Getting ready to knock down a couple of buildings. This is on the north. I'd call it the northeast side. Not past Kings Island. Still a little more in the downtown. Older part of the city. Roads are narrow. No fun. Doubtful I'll ever take this loop. How'd it snow when I get out of here? That load at Siemens in Cincinnati, and I will never haul for Siemens again. The roads they took us down, horrible. They just gave the city of Cincinnati a free tree trimming service. I'll never haul it. I'll never take that load again. They'd have to double the pay on that load to get me to take it again. Anyway, heading home. North of Cincinnati, south of Columbus, going north. Where I live, water flows more, so that a little bit of clue how far north of Columbus I live. I got a new stereo in this truck, and I'll give you a review on it after I've had it in here for a little bit. So far, it's done pretty good, but I'm gonna play a song on the way home. I hope y'all like it. A guy named Hardy, and if all you listen to the radio, you probably never heard of him. But I really like his music, and if you like country and southern rock, you probably like it. But give it a listen.